Hello, everyone. My name is Stephen Dolman, a service delivery lead at York Calgary Public Library. It is my honor and privilege to introduce Dr. Carolyn Muessig, our host for this afternoon's program. Dr. Muessig arrived in Calgary in July of this year from the University of Bristol, Department of Religion and Theology, to take up the endowed chair of Christian thought in the Department of Classics and Religion. Dr. Muessig is a specialist in the field of medieval Christianity and has published widely on the history of preaching, medieval mystics such as Hildegard of Bingen and Catherine of Siena. This year, her book, The Stigmata in Medieval and Early Modern Europe, was published with Oxford University Press. As holder of the Chair of Christian Thought, Dr. Muessig engages in knowledge translation and initiates and organizes community events. The Iwaasa Lecture on Urban Theology is one of four annual endowed public lectures that the Chair of Christian Thought organizes. The three others are the Swanson Lecture in Spirituality, the LaBelle Lecture in Christian Ethics, and the Bentall Lecture on Education and Theology. These lectures demonstrate the breadth and depth of Christian culture and reflect how numerous disciplines intersect with the study of religion. Dr. Muessig and the Calgary Public Library have teamed up in partnership with the aim of making the Endowed Chair of Christian Thought public lectures accessible to a wide audience across not only Calgary, but the whole of Alberta. Through such activities, we will be building partnerships and communities across the academy, the city and province in an endeavor to encourage informed discussions in relation to Christianity and more generally to make better known the cultural importance of religion, past and present. Without further delay, please join me in welcoming our host this afternoon, Dr. Carolyn Muessig.
Thank you very much, Stephen. I'm honored to initiate my role as Chair of Christian Thought from the beautiful new Calgary Public Library. And it is my pleasure to introduce Dr. Kristin Du Mez, who this year is giving the Chair of Christian Thought Iwaasa Lecture on Urban Theology. This endowed lecture is named in the memory of Reverend Kaz Iwaasa, who served as Minister of Church and Society in the Central United Church in Calgary. I add with sadness that his devoted wife, Inger, passed away earlier this year at the age of 90. So today, let us remember both Inger and Reverend Kaz Iwaasa. Dr. Du Mez is Professor of History and Gender Studies at Calvin University in Michigan, where she is speaking from this afternoon. Dr. Du Mez's research focuses on the intersection of gender, religion, and politics. Her first book, A New Gospel for Women, Catherine Bushnell and the Challenge of Christian Feminism, published in 2015 with Oxford University Press, examined the 19th century social reformer Catherine Bushnell, as well as the difficulties women faced in coming to terms with changing constructions of sexuality, morality, and religion in modern America. She is presently working on another book entitled Journey of Faith, Hillary Clinton and the Polarization of American Christianity. In addition to her scholarly accomplishments in the academy, Dr. Du Mez demonstrates effectively how academic research can help make sense and bring understanding to perplexing social, religious, and political issues in the public domain. Her articulation on perplexing topics has been featured in many articles written for the Washington Post, Religion News Service, Christianity Today, Christian Century, and in interviews with the BBC, CBC, CTV, NPR, the list goes on. Her most recent book, Jesus and John Wayne, How White Evangelicals Corrupted a Faith and Fractured a Nation, is a study of white evangelical views of masculinity from the Cold War to the present, culminating in the election of Donald Trump. Dr. Du Mez, welcome. Can you tell us where this idea to write Jesus and John Wayne came from? Thank you.
Sure. And thank you, Dr. Muessig. And thank you, Dean Sigurdsson and the Calgary Public Library and University of Calgary. I am deeply sad that I'm not with you all. And just so you know, I did go online earlier and I saw your phenomenal building at the library. It was breathtaking even just to see on the website. And so I am there in spirit. And I'm also deeply grateful to have a role to play in the celebration and welcoming of Dr. Muessig to this chair in Christian thought, which is such an important position and kind of the investment in understanding of religion and its public ramifications is just so critical today. So it is a delight to be with you all. So where the idea of Jesus and John Wayne began, although the book, the first page of the book opens with a story of Donald Trump actually appearing on the stage of my alma mater, a small college in Iowa, back in 2016, where he said that he could stand in the middle of Fifth Avenue and shoot somebody and not lose any voters. That was my alma mater, where he said that the book itself did not start with Donald Trump, not at all. It started more than 15 years ago, the idea for this research. And I was a new faculty member at Calvin University, a Christian university, and I was teaching one of my first courses on U.S. history. And I had a little unit on Teddy Roosevelt, which I thought was a great way to introduce students to the study of gender, to the idea of how masculinity works. And masculinity isn't just a private matter. It's linked to changing economic situations. It's linked to foreign policy, in the case of Teddy Roosevelt, to US empire. And so I had this nice little unit. And at the end of that lecture, a couple of guys in my class came up to me and said, "Professor Du Mez, there's this book that you really need to read." Now, this was back in around 2005. And the book that they told me about was this book right here, John Eldridge's Wild at Heart, Discovering the Secret of a Man's Soul. Now, back in 2005, this book was all the rage in Christian universities, dorm rooms, evangelical churches. It sold more than 4 million copies. And it was a vision of Christian manhood, of Christian masculinity that was essentially militant and militaristic at its heart. So if you read Eldridge, you would learn that God is a warrior God, and every man is made in the image of that warrior, and every man has a battle to fight and a beauty to rescue. Now, I read the book, just like my students told me to do, and I saw immediately what they were talking about. It opened with a quote from Teddy Roosevelt, and it went on to sketch this, again, essentially militant, militaristic conception of Christian manhood. And like I had just been teaching my students, I was curious, how does this vision of Christian manhood connect to issues of foreign policy, to larger cultural and political issues? Now, again, this was 2005 during the Iraq War. And at this time, we were seeing survey data coming out and one survey after another showing us that white evangelicals at that time were real outliers over against the rest of the U.S. population when it came to support for the Iraq War, support for preemptive war in general, condoning the use of torture, embracing an aggressive foreign policy. And so I started to examine how this conception of militant Christian masculinity might connect to this very aggressive foreign policy. And then after about a year of kind of digging around, I set the project aside for a time. I didn't know how long. I had my first book to finish. I had a couple of kids in quick succession. But I also had this kind of underlying question. First of all, what I was uncovering was deeply disturbing to me as a person of faith, as an American citizen. And related to that, I wasn't entirely clear just how mainstream this was, right? I was reading this disturbing rhetoric and, highly militaristic language, often also highly misogynistic language. I knew that this particular book had sold more than 4 million copies. I knew that there were now dozens of other kind of copycat books out. I knew this was the era of Mark Driscoll out in Seattle, this prominent megachurch pastor who was incredibly crass and misogynistic and militaristic. But I just wasn't entirely sure, like, do I want to shine this bright light on what might end up being the darkest underbelly of American Christianity? And how do I really tease this out? Is this fringe or is this mainstream? So those were the ideas that were kind of challenging me. But I had other things on my plate. So I set it aside. I didn't entirely stop paying attention, however. And in ensuing years, I saw how one after another of the pastors and leaders that I had already been tracing, with the exception of Eldridge — this doesn't apply to John Eldridge — but one after another of the guys who had been promoting this very militant conception of masculinity became implicated either directly or indirectly in scandals, abuses of power, or in many, many cases, sexual abuse scandals, either as perpetrators or as defenders of their friends who are perpetrators. And so I took notes, I kept track. And I always planned to return to it at some point. And then in a run-up to the 2016 election, as Dr. Muessig noted, I was researching a book on Hillary Clinton and her faith formation. And so I was keeping a very careful watch over the electorate, particularly white evangelicals who particularly did not like Hillary Clinton. And I watched them as they slowly but surely started to back Donald Trump. And this was not initially a top-down phenomenon, not at all. Many evangelical leaders were very reluctant to back Trump. He was an unknown. He was a wild card. Could they trust him? He was certainly not their conventional religious right candidate. But at the popular level, he was gaining momentum. And I watched this support coalesce early 2016 behind Donald Trump and sustain itself through the Republican National Convention. And I saw great levels of enthusiasm. And then just a little over 4 years ago, exactly this month, we had the Access Hollywood tape. The tape that made clear to the world that Donald Trump was bragging about sexual assault in very crass language, and kind of the country stopped and watched, right? What is going to happen next, particularly with his white evangelical base? Surely they cannot support him, right? These are family values evangelicals. They are the moral majority. Surely this is going to be a step too far. We saw a very small number of evangelicals at that point waver in their support. But within a week, they were all back behind all of those who had been supporting him up to that point. And that's when it clicked for me. And suddenly I realized, we've seen this before. We have seen this over and over again in white evangelical churches, organizations, and communities. Support for men who abuse power, for sexual abusers. And I think I understand what's happening here. And in fact, not long after, just 3 or 4 weeks later, the election made clear. We saw exit polls reporting that 81% of white evangelicals did in fact vote for Donald Trump, and that support was absolutely critical to putting him in the White House. At the time, one of the real narratives was, how could evangelicals betray their values and vote for a man like Donald Trump? But what I understood from my research into the history of white evangelical masculinity and militarism, research that I started to dust off right at that point, because my question of marginal versus mainstream, I think, had been answered. What I knew from that research is that this was not a betrayal of evangelical values. If we look back to history, we will see that the support of a militant white masculinity, patriarchy, has always been at the center of family values evangelicalism, that you can go back and see this support, this justification that God made men to be warriors. He made men to be warriors so that they would be strong enough. He filled them with testosterone so they would be aggressive enough to defend their families, their faith, and their nation. And sometimes, oftentimes, men who were not particularly deeply formed by traditional Christian virtues, such as love and gentleness and self-control, love of one's neighbor, precisely those were the men who were most equipped to fight the battles that they needed to fight. And in fact, when I had read John Eldridge's Wild at Heart, and when I read all of these other books that were being written about this, you know, Christian masculinity, what I quickly saw was, for all their talk of being Bible-believing Christians and really, really centering the scriptures as the authority in their lives, these books did not center the scriptures at all. Instead, they drew on Hollywood heroes and on mythical warriors like Mel Gibson's William Wallace from the movie Braveheart, from cowboys and soldiers, and from John Wayne, the actor John Wayne, the man that John Wayne portrayed. And this was entirely consistent with what we saw in their embrace of Donald Trump. It was precisely the man who was not formed by Christian virtue, who was rugged enough and tough enough to do what needed to be done. And so that's where Jesus and John Wayne came from.
Wow, that was quite a journey. I guess unwanted discovery on some yes. level too, yeah. a surprise. Now, this is a book about, I should first say, I just ask one or two more questions if that's okay. And then we can open the floor up to questions from the audience. I have lots of questions, so I'll give them time to think about that. But I'd like to just ask you this. This is a book about American evangelicals, and what you're saying, it's really, American politics, this is really a focal point and a crisis moment in many ways of what you're discussing. Does it matter beyond the United States and in Canada in particular, this notion of American evangelicals?
Yes, this is very much a story that's rooted in U.S. history. World War II, and that's when you see kind of evangelicals coalescing in the National Association of Evangelicals and really kind of embracing Christian nationalism and the idea that this militarism, but it was really the early Cold War where these strands started to come together. Again, very much kind of American history where we see gender traditionalism really coming together with militarism and Christian nationalism, and we're still kind of living with that legacy today. But then it was the Vietnam War that was a crystallizing moment for white evangelicals, because that's when you see many other Americans who had embraced these values start to step back and critique and start to reject militarism, reject American greatness and goodness, at least as many conservative evangelicals had embraced it. But white evangelicals, it was their really at the center of their political and religious identity to continue to hold fast to those and in opposition to the rest of America. So that part, it's very much an American story. That said, I look at evangelicalism as a cultural movement, and one in which its values are largely distributed through popular culture and through media. And in that way, conservative evangelicals have been able to spread their values and their ideals throughout America into the mainline churches, into the homes of people who may not even attend church. And so it's been very powerful and influential in the United States. But through those distribution networks, they were also able to spread many of these teachings, again, through the popular culture, into other countries. And I've talked with a number of Canadian Christians who will attest that the teachings, the Christian radio, the Christian publishing has absolutely spread across the border. And it has influenced Christianity in Canada. But again, the setting is different. And so in America, it's linked up with this Christian nationalism, with American individualism, with American militarism. And so it's not without effects in Canada, but it doesn't quite take root in the same way. And it's not just Canada. Jesus and John Wayne has ended up getting quite extensive global coverage, which means I've now been hearing from Christians around the world who are attesting to the fact that precisely these teachings, precisely this popular culture has been spread into Kenya, into the Netherlands, into Germany, into China, and very much into Brazil. And they are all dealing with the consequences of abusive power, sexual abuse in these religious communities, and also in certain cases, and particularly in Brazil, in evangelicals' embrace of authoritarianism. So the patterns are actually very disturbing, and I'm working with activists and Christians in many other countries to try to address this.
Mm-hmm. That kind of, again, let me just remind our audience that you are welcome to type into the chat option any questions you might have. So I'll just ask one more question as we get there. And what you've just said, Dr. Du Mez, anticipates that. And it's been about five months since your book has come out or so.
Yep, almost, yeah.
So you've already indicated right there that there have been some responses to it and people hearing it resonate with what they know. I was wondering, and what have been the responses, the range of responses to you?
Yeah, so when I published this book and I decided to say what I thought needed to be said, and I decided not to avoid controversy, as I think the subtitle suggests, I expected considerable backlash. And in fact, I've been incredibly surprised by the reception of the book, particularly within white evangelical communities. Which doesn't mean that everybody loves it, but apparently most of the people who don't like it are staying quiet about it. It has and continues every day. I get letters. I've received more than 200 letters from white evangelicals themselves. And it's white evangelicals who are largely promoting the book right now, having me on their podcasts and putting it up on Instagram and Twitter and Facebook and telling everybody that they need to read it. So many pastors are reading the book, promoting it, writing about it, and saying essentially some version of, this is the story of my life, and this is not okay. And because it's a cultural history, right, talking about the popular culture of evangelicalism, what radio did you listen to? What books did you get, you know, from when you graduated eighth grade? And what did you do with your youth group? What movies did you watch, right? It's this evangelical subculture. And so many people recognize that, and that is the story of their lives. I did not expect that so many would be open to self-critique. And in what I'm hearing from so many, I mean, just today I was talking with a pastor online who blogged about it this morning, saying that it helped him understand his own complicity in propping up this culture, in not confronting racism in his own church, in not having the courage to speak out against what he was seeing, you know, in the name of unity, when he realized there was no unity there. And so the soul searching that this book has provoked, not despite its provocative nature, I think, but precisely because of its honesty, is really encouraging to me. I did not have a lot of hope, frankly, when I wrapped up this book. I found it incredibly discouraging. But the reception of the book since it came out this summer does give me some hope. I had no idea how many evangelicals themselves who are complicit are also troubled by this, and at a time right now are willing to open up and to rethink some of these things. And I think that the history too allows them to do that in a way that it's not direct confrontation. Initially, history allows you to ask the question, How did things get to be the way they are now? And it shows that things did not always look this way, right? Christian nationalism was not always embraced by all conservative Protestants. Conceptions of Christian manhood did not always embrace militarism, not at all. Conservative evangelicals had not always embraced the US military. And so once you realize that this is not inevitable, that all of these decisions were made by individuals, often interested in consolidating their own power, then you can start to say, well, if that's how we got to where we are now, and if it wasn't inevitable, is this actually where we want to be?
I'm just going to intervene here too, because we have some questions, and I'm going to read them out. I hope our technicians, hosts don't mind, because I see a question that's come in that resonates right with what you're saying. Is the term evangelical changing its meaning entirely in the American context?
Yeah.
It doesn't seem to mean what I learned it meant in classes a few decades ago.
Yes, that's such a good question and a very important question, and was one of the early questions that I faced when I set out to write this book, right? What are we even talking about? Who are evangelicals? And there's a kind of traditional theological definition of evangelicals that evangelicals tend to use themselves. And that is essentially talking about they uphold the authority of the scriptures. Again, that's self-identification there, and crucicentrism, so the atoning work of Christ is right at the heart of it, conversionism, having a born-again experience, and then activism, acting out of your faith. And so that's kind of one working definition. I think historically, globally, it's kind of meant not mainline in this very evangelistic, revivalistic tradition. And again, globally, it still has these connotations. In the United States, in recent decades, the term has, in fact, been taking on a different meaning. And a lot of evangelicals right now, evangelical leaders, don't like that. So they're trying to push back and say, no, no, no. So right now, evangelical increasingly means white evangelical. And it means white conservative evangelicals who vote Republican. And again, some evangelicals now are really fighting back against that. That's not who we are. Historically, that's not who we have been. Now, as a historian and not an evangelical, you know, myself trying to change evangelicalism, at least not in that way, I actually look at what evangelicalism has come to mean. And what we can see is that as it has, in fact, increasingly come to mean white evangelical or white conservative Christian who votes Republican, now many people who are self-identifying as evangelicals are identifying with this new meaning. And so you will still have some evangelicals who are progressive and who will want to kind of claim that evangelicalism is not exclusively conservative. Many of those are giving up and have been giving up in the last 4 years. And so you're seeing this kind of sorting out. Many more progressive or even moderate evangelicals are like, you know what, I'm not evangelical anymore. I'm done here. And so in some ways, evangelicalism, that's actually, you know, increasing the speed with which evangelicalism is becoming more conservative, white, and Republican. Many people of color as well, Black Protestants, may have previously identified as evangelical, but the more that the category itself is taking on this racial connotation, the more Black Christians are saying, no, I am not evangelical. And in fact, many have long resisted the category and have insisted that that is a white religious brand. So it's a contested word. People are going to use it and mean different things by it. And so I was quite careful to define it as a cultural movement and as something that we can understand and really need to be understanding through the popular culture and the networks and organizations that make up this evangelical subculture.
Great. That this is kind of leads into another question here that's just, where is it? What you're alluding to right at the end there. The question is, why is it that we are not hearing from these progressive, moderate evangelical groups you described during the election?
No. Because they don't have, they are speaking, trust me. I'm listening to them, I'm watching them. And there are organizations like Sojourners and Jim Wallace, and you know, they're very progressive. And they are—they have long been speaking against the Trump administration, and you know, for the rights of immigrants and refugees, and you know, so they are absolutely speaking. In fact, many moderate evangelical organizations like Christianity Today has been fascinating to watch. They are also speaking out against the Trump administration and through editorials and so forth. But so you still have that diversity and political diversity. But as a historian, I need to respect that diversity, but also analyze that through the lens of power. So which groups have more power right now, and in which spokespeople have more followers behind them, right? And so I actually think this kind of 81%, you know, the exit polls suggesting 81% of white evangelicals support Trump versus that leaves 19% is kind of the ratio that I tend to see. So you're always going to find somebody over here in the 19% who says, no, I'm not okay with this. But many of those folks also, apart from like the organizations, and it's a place like Christianity Today too, they've really struggled with this. They've really tried to negotiate because they know if they speak out forcefully, they're going to lose a whole slew of subscribers. And each time they do, and then they're going to get other ones. But it's actually a perilous time right now for many evangelical organizations, precisely because of this ratio. So a lot of times more elite evangelicals, the leaders of these organizations, are the ones who are more likely to be in the 19%. But they know that many of their donors, their constituents, their subscribers are in the 81%. And so that's led to a lot of soul searching and quite a bit of quietism, frankly, in evangelical organizations. And a real crisis in evangelical leadership. Because many who have traditionally defined themselves as leaders, who are leaders, are discovering the limits of their leadership. In fact, they're the ones who are going to be out on the curb if they try to go up against this populist movement. And so it really is a crisis right now. Pastors are leaving their churches, either being forced out or just walking away because they realize that they cannot minister to their congregations anymore. Every organization is having to make choices right now.
Yeah, thanks. There's a question here that relates really to the title of the lecture and to the title of your book. Can you please talk about Jesus and John Wayne and how they relate to the book, to the lecture, you know, the title? What is that title?
Sure. So I alluded to this briefly before, right, that when I started looking at Christian writings on masculinity that were really promoting a very militant conception of what it meant to be a Christian man. You needed to be rugged. You needed to fight. You needed to use violence when necessary. Mm-hmm. This was not largely based on the Christian scriptures, right? So it was Christian, but the sources of inspiration were being pulled from Hollywood movies. From Mel Gibson's William Wallace was a huge favorite, from just movies about cowboys and about soldiers and mythical warriors. And then I noticed like over and over again, John Wayne kept popping up. So John Wayne is, of course, this American actor who rose to prominence in the 1940s as a hero of Westerns, right? The good guys, a good guy against the bad guys, the guy with the gun who, again, could bring order through violence. And then by the late 40s, he was also starring in World War II movies. So he took this kind of cowboy heroism, individualism, you know, the Wild West, and then brought that to the U.S. military. And so he starred in Sands of Iwo Jima. So this World War II soldier who could, you know, America, the good guys on the global stage. And again, bring order, global order through violence. And then he stars in the Green Berets, one of the only, actually the only major motion picture made in the United States during Vietnam that was kind of pro-Vietnam, pro-war in Vietnam. And there he brought the heroism of the cowboy together with the heroism of, you know, of the good war in onto the battlefields of Vietnam, right? Fictional, of course. But that was the war that many Americans, especially conservative Americans, wanted to believe in. So that's who John Wayne was on screen. And he became America's most popular actor only a few years ago, even though he died decades ago. Only a few years ago did he slip down from that top notch of America's favorite actor. Now, by the 1970s, he had really come to stand as an icon of American masculinity, and particularly of conservative masculinity, because he stood for this traditional manhood over against the anti-war protesters, over against the civil rights movement, right? He was a model of militant white masculinity and very much over against feminism. So he came to symbolize this conservative masculinity and conservative politics. He, in fact, was active in politics. He supported Barry Goldwater in 1964. He was a close friend of Ronald Reagan and supported Ronald Reagan. And he has become now this kind of icon of especially conservative and retrograde American masculinity. And what's interesting then is that American evangelicals too have come to embrace him. He was not an evangelical. He did not live according to Christian values, not at all, but he symbolized this cultural identity that they too had come to embrace. This rugged, traditional, violent when necessary, white masculinity, conservative white masculinity. And that's what they love about him. And that's why they keep coming back to him in their books. What that does then, again, he was such a great model of, you know, quote unquote, Christian manhood, precisely because he wasn't formed by Christian virtues. He was tough enough to do what needed to be done. And so that's this pattern that we see really repeated. And that's why I thought it was perfect for the title, because he was deeply implicated in this political history that I was writing, but even more so the perfect symbol of the cultural identity where this militant white patriarchy was, and a very nostalgic white patriarchy was right at the heart. And that's really what John Wayne symbolizes today, which is why it's no coincidence that right now in recent months, there have been huge debates about John Wayne and his legacy. In the wake of the police killing of George Floyd earlier this summer, in the Black Lives Matter movement, there was renewed effort to rename John Wayne Airport in Orange County, California, because it symbolizes this racist past and this kind of a white patriarchy. And USC took down their John Wayne exhibit. So then President Trump tweeted in defense of John Wayne. President Trump has been compared repeatedly to John Wayne by his followers, and he represents John Wayne America. So John Wayne is this kind of cultural symbol that absolutely epitomizes the values that conservative evangelicals have embraced and have really kind of baptized as Christian values.
Thank you. I'm going to combine two questions here because they relate one after the other. Why haven't the hypocrisy of the leaders such as Falwell and Faye Baker families, etc., done more to undermine the spread of evangelical groups in the USA? And the question right after that, to what extent have narratives of sin and forgiveness been co-opted to enable the abuses you describe?
Exactly. So what we see and what I came to see when I looked at evangelical writing about gender, about masculinity and femininity, sexuality is very important. And evangelicals read and publish so many books about sex. So it's this kind of favorite topic, sex and gender. And what was startling to me initially, and then I got really used to it, was seeing how these kind of gender ideals of gender difference shape their understanding of human sexuality. So God filled men with testosterone, which means they have an aggressive sex drive too, God made them that way. That's just the way they are. And restraint isn't really their thing. Boys will be boys. God made women very different. They are to be sweet and they are to be submissive and pure. And so virtue really rests on the shoulders of women. And so they need to be modest so that they don't tempt these men, because again, boys will be boys. And so this framework very much shapes their understanding of sexuality. It is the duty of a woman to not tempt a man who is not her husband. And it is the duty of a woman who is married, of a wife, to fully fulfill her husband's sexual needs, and they are many and aggressive, which leads to the situation that when a man engages in sexual misconduct, it is his wife's fault if he is married, because clearly she wasn't meeting his needs sufficiently, and or it is the victim's fault for tempting him, even if the victim is a five-year-old child. And it is startling to see how these patterns repeat in cases of sexual abuse. And then at the same time, you see this absolutely in literature on sexuality in evangelical communities. So that is part of it. All of which is to say, the conditions are there to set up for very quickly forgiving and excusing a male perpetrator, and finding a woman to blame. And the last chapter of my book, in fact, is this awful history of sexual abuse in evangelical communities, one after another, after another. And you see this pattern absolutely repeated. And earlier in the book, I tell about the Christian sex manuals and the teachings on sexuality, and you can just see the echoes are so clear. And so Falwell Jr. is one in a long, long line of these repeated patterns. And right, the view of sin, this is something I talk about more than once in the book, you know, for evangelicals who are, you know, worried about sin, or, you know, they seem remarkably unconcerned about putting a lot of power, of unchecked power, in the hands of the patriarch, of a white patriarch in particular. And they can get away with so much, and the community around them ends up wanting to protect the witness of the pastor, protect the witness of the church, protect the brand. And this is absolutely what we see over and over again, and really needs to be called out, and is called out in the book. Particularly, I quote an incredibly powerful kind of testimony of Rachel Den Hollander, who has really taken on the issue of advocating for survivors of sexual abuse in the United States. And she takes on the evangelical community directly and says, God does not need your protection, right? God demands obedience and justice. And that's certainly a motif of this book.
It's very powerful. A question, any comments on alliance with conservative wing of Roman Catholicism? Is it only about anti-abortion, or is it broader?
Yeah. Yes, that's a really good question. So we do see historically conservative Catholics and evangelicals unite around the issue of abortion. Catholics were there first. Many conservative evangelicals were not all that concerned about evangelical or about abortion, with some exceptions, but there was a lot of variety of views as late as the late 60s and early 70s in conservative evangelical churches. And they considered it really a Catholic issue, and they didn't like Catholics, and so it wasn't their issue. They end up coming together around that issue and an entire kind of constellation of issues. So conservative white Catholics and conservative white evangelicals end up uniting around, you know, this family values Christianity, also around traditional gender roles and American militarism, aggressive foreign policy. All of these things really unite conservative Catholics and white evangelicals, and unite these groups with secular conservatives as well, particularly in terms of militarism and also traditional gender roles, right? So there's this cultural identity. I'm focusing on how this has materialized and what it looks like in conservative white evangelical communities. But this cultural identity with white patriarchy at the heart absolutely unites conservative evangelicals with conservative white Catholics and with secular white conservatives as well.
Thank you. Okay, another question. Your presentation rhymes with the journey of a young writer, Rachel Held Evans, Searching for Sunday. In Canada and elsewhere, people who challenge perceived order experience some violence through social media and otherwise. Has this also been your experience? And thank you for being present with us through these lectures.
Oh, thank you. I was warned when this before this book came out by my publisher's lawyer to expect to be viciously trolled. And so I was kind of, how do you prepare for that? You know, I tried to lock down my kids' pictures and behind privacy walls. And again, I have not seen that much in, at all in the way of trolling. There's a little bit out there. Interestingly, I had been invited to give a very public talk at my alma mater on the very stage where Trump had made his claim about standing on the middle of Fifth Avenue. So I thought, how poetic. And that's how I opened my book and I got to go. And it's a conservative Christian university. Mm-hmm. And that ended up, it's in one of the most conservative counties in the country. And so that did end up, my invitation there ended up stirring up some controversy. And the college did not rescind my invitation. I was still welcome to come. Unfortunately, high COVID cases there made it impossible. The last minute, the trip needed to be moved to remote, so I was not able to be there in person. But there was some opposition, some trolling. You could Google it. I actually don't Google trolls because I don't want to amplify their power. Even in my own head, I welcome like legit critics any day. But apart from that, I have not experienced the harsh level of pushback that some others have, and I've kind of wondered about that. I think one of the reasons why is, first of all, I'm an academic and I'm a historian. And so the book is not an opinion piece. There's some opinion thrown in here or there, but I mean, it's meticulously documented. So I think it's a powerful work that's a little bit harder to dismiss. I also went outside of kind of Christian communities. I went with a secular trade publisher. I have academic freedom and the support of my institution. And so I think it's just a little bit, it's harder maybe to target me. Whereas if you are inside these communities, right, if you are, I don't identify as an evangelical, although I am a person of faith, I'm a professing Christian, I'm not an evangelical. I think it's when you are deemed an insider that you are especially targeted. And so I don't know. It hasn't been very bad. I see other people still getting viciously attacked. I realize things could change any day. Sometimes I'm nervous talking about it like this. I don't want to invite that. But I was prepared that might actually happen. And but that fear, I think, has kept, again, many, many evangelicals, many Christians from speaking out. Fear of even just offending their own family members, of losing friends. And early on in this process, I had seen that pattern repeated, right? I had seen deference to power end up causing so much harm that I just decided I would not participate that in that in any way. And so I think that the title of the book, subtitled the tone that I take in the book, throughout the book, if you have read it, you will see I am absolutely refusing to participate in that, to defer to these power structures. And that's something that might end up inviting some backlash, but that's something that I'm willing to risk.
Thank you. Is there really a recent phenomenon? Is this really a recent phenomena? And is it really limited to evangelicals? It seems to me, and authors I have read, that is actually a fundamental part of colonialism and therefore a fundamental part of North American culture, not just evangelicalism. For example, the Christian Church, long before evangelicalism, gave its blessing to genocide and the doctrine of discovery.
Yes. Yes, and yes, I agree with that all. So in the United States, in this moment, I would say that white evangelicals are more boldly performing this than any other group, and with some pretty dire consequences. But this is not new, and it is linked to colonialism more recently. It might even just be an expression of human nature, depending on how you understand that, right? This quest for power, and in recent history has absolutely been linked to whiteness, patriarchy, and all of this pursued in the name of Christianity. So yes, there's nothing new here. And in fact, I will say that is one of my qualms about the subtitle of the book, the corrupted a faith part. That is not a historical claim. So I want to be clear about that. The book is largely a work of history, like I said, and then it has this kind of critical framing. And the corrupted a faith part doesn't make a lot of sense historically, because yes, you can certainly find evidences of this throughout the history of evangelicalism, despite what many evangelicals tell themselves. They love to hold somebody up like Jonathan Edwards and George Whitefield. And those are the lovely, true evangelicals. And if only we can return to that. But of course, Whitefield absolutely promoted slavery, and Jonathan Edwards owned slaves. And we need to reckon with that history too, right? This is not nothing new. And this is just deeply, deeply embedded in the faith tradition, in white Christianity generally, and in evangelicalism in particular. I went with that subtitle for a couple of reasons. First of all, this is a trade book, and I've always considered this a book about white evangelical masculinity and militarism. And the sales team right away told us you cannot use the word masculinity or militarism anywhere in the title or subtitle, because they're too big, right? So that we need to sell this book. And so you gotta, start from scratch. It took us 3 months to come up with the subtitle. In the end, I came up with, we came up with this. And they left me the choice of transformed a faith or corrupted a faith. And I was like, yeah, we got to go corrupted. And what that refers to is this is speaking kind of directly to self-professed Bible-believing evangelicals. Because in the book, I give many examples of how, the scriptures that they claim to uphold as, the greatest authority in all of, in shaping life, that they explicitly reject very clear teachings, such as, turn the other cheek, love your enemy, turn the other cheek. They will explicitly say, you can't teach a boy to become a man if you tell him to turn the other cheek, do away with that. The fruits of the Spirit, right? The Beatitudes, right? All of these things. The doctrine of the Trinity, they actually throw out in order to kind of promote their brand of, white patriarchal Christianity. So that's the corruption of the faith. It's more of a theological claim, and that part is not a historical claim. So it's a really good question.
Great. Well, we have time for one more question, so I'll feed that through. So far you've talked mostly about the white conservative identity. However, my sense is that evangelical Christianity is growing rapidly in the developing world. What accounts for the attraction over other branches outside the USA?
Yeah, so that's absolutely right. And evangelicalism, again, it can mean different things in different contexts. And so I think there are a lot of things that explain the attraction of evangelicalism. And you really have to look at different locations to see. One of the things that it spreads, again, through popular culture, it's never bounded by denominations or established institutions. So it can spread quite quickly. They've always been really great with kind of utilizing modern communications, media. All of these things work in the favor of spreading. It's also often linked with prosperity gospel teachings, which can be very attractive in many areas in the developing world. Sometimes it's embraced by women in particular, who see it as kind of liberating from existing patriarchal structures, right? Evangelicalism, Christianity in general can be turned towards patriarchal expressions, or it can be used to empower women in different contexts, depending where you're coming from, depending which passages from the Bible you're really drawn to and used to shape. So it's very very diverse in its manifestations. And now what we will also see, however, is we have kind of global expressions of evangelicalism, some of which predate missionary contact, many of which do date to missionary contact in the 19th century, and then they've kind of, you know, grown up on their own. But now what we also see is this brand of white American conservative evangelicalism is being actively exported, right? Where I mentioned that earlier, but actively exported through precisely the organizations I'm writing about here, back into those existing global and evangelical communities. And so it is reshaping and often turning local expressions of the faith into harsher, more patriarchal, and often more nationalist expressions of it. So it's very dynamic and complex.
Well, thank you. Well, unfortunately, we are out of time. And I just want to, before we sign off and thank our speaker and audience, just to tell people who are listening that if you'd like to support your local bookshops, and I'm sure you do, Shelf Life Books in Calgary is carrying several copies of Jesus and John Wayne. So please support your local bookshops, Shelf Life Books. I want to say a great thank you to the audience for your wonderful questions. I'm sorry we couldn't get through them all. And Dr. Du Mez, thank you so much for spending time with us and really making very accessible, very complex and perplexing issues in politics, religion, and gender. Thank you so much.
Thank you. It was a delight to be here. Thank you all.
Thank you.